Welcome. Welcome as we gather here at Beautiful Savior. As we worship this day, first we have to say probably the elephant in the room. As we rejoice in the good news of what the CDC announced this week, with that lifting or rolling back or changing, however you want to say it, of how we understand mask guidelines, you'll probably notice that for those that are here and those that are watching, we are still saying masks at this time as we wait for those new guidelines to come out that aren't out yet for the state of Washington. So, especially when it comes to singing, that is still something we are waiting to hear how singing, the spread, masks, vaccines, we're just saying let's go with what has been said as we wait what new regulations are going to come out, and we're just going to tread cautiously. But we give thanks for the new guidelines that are there. As we do this, I know many people are just a bit tired of everything going on, and they just can't wait for things to be done. It's the, it would be wonderful just to be done with it all. And it's a glorious day to celebrate that as we celebrate Ascension today, as we celebrate our Lord going to heaven, rising up and saying his goodbyes as he returns from whence he came. But is this really the end? Today we ask that question and see, no, ascension isn't the end, but this is where our Lord's mission now goes out to the world. So today we join together celebrating that ascension now is where we gather together, hearing the command that isn't the end of what our Lord has done, but where we now hear of that call to go and tell. As we gather this day, let's begin with our first song.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
As we gather rejoicing this day, we know that we have a Lord who isn't far away off in the clouds, but we gather in his name as his people. We gather knowing that he is here with us when we call upon him by name. And so we begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. We hear in the Psalms and rejoice that this word has come true. God has ascended. Lift up shouts of joy.
Sing praises to God.
Sing praises.
Sing praises to our King. Jesus is the King of all the earth.
Sing to him a song of praise.
God rules over the nations. Jesus is seated on his holy throne. We have a God who is there in heaven, who now through his actions is an advocate for us, who when we call upon him, when we are in need, when we sin and fall short, he doesn't condemn us, but instead through his actions has forgiven us. And so let us confess those sins. Let us go and turn to him and his throne of mercy. As we confess our sins to God and one another, let us turn and confess. Jesus Christ, risen Master and triumphant Lord, we confess to you in sorrow for our sins, and we confess to you our weakness and our unbelief. Jesus, the King enthroned on high, you fill the earth with your glory. Holy is your name. Lord God Almighty, in our sinfulness, we cry to you to take our guilt away and cleanse our lips to speak your words. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Sisters and brothers of our risen King, lift up shouts of joy because we have an ascended Lord who has returned to heaven and now announces that forgiveness because he reigns. His victory is assured, and we know where we stand because of what he has done for you. In his stead and by his command, I announce to you that glorious forgiveness that he has won, that you now stand in as we shout up songs and psalms of joy, that your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. This truly is a glorious day. This is glorious reasons that we gather in praise. And so let us announce that with our next song, Here I Am to Worship.
Together, lovely,
altogether loving, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
How wonderful is it? How wonderful is it that we can gather, that we have a Lord who has paid it all for us, who has done it all, and we now rejoice knowing that he has prepared a place. He has prepared a room in his Father's house for us. And we now know that wonderful news as we hear and share that wonderful word in peace. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let's turn to God in a word of prayer. O Jesus Christ, Almighty Son of God, we lift up to you prayers, praise, thanksgiving, and we lift up to you that wonderful news of your holy gospel with thanks, that now all earth sings your praise, that you are seated at the right hand of your Father, that you are the Lord of all things. We call out to you, as you have promised to send your Holy Spirit to give your church your word, that you fill us with your mission. We pray, Lord, that you would reduce all those desires, temptations, all the things that drive us away from you. Lift us up to have spirits, eyes, ears that focus on your kingdom until all of your enemies, until all the world, until all of our lives are focused on you and what you have done and that victory that we now announce with joy on our lips. This is what we pray as your people, to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, to which all God's people said, Amen. Amen. As we turn to our choir at this time, who have been singing praises throughout this pandemic from their houses, we give thanks to Kim for all of her work in arranging all of these choir pieces. We share that peace with each other. We share that peace that goes well beyond our understanding, just as we share that peace that we now have because of what God has done for us. God's peace be with you all.
Thank you.
Acts chapter 1, starting at verse 1. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. After giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen, after his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or the dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witness in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven."
The second reading comes from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 through 23. "For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and your love for all God's people, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in all his holy people, and his incomparable great power for us who believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way."
And today's scripture, gospel reading is taken from the book of Luke, chapter 24, verses 44 through 53. "He said to them, 'This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms.' Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, 'This is what is written: the Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high.' When he had led them out to the vicinity of Bethany, he lifted up his hands and blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. Then they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they stayed continually at the temple, praising God." These are the words of our Lord.
Jesus, I believe in Jesus. Son of God. I believe he died and rose again. I believe he paid for us all. And I believe he's here now, standing in our midst, here with the power to heal now, and the grace to forgive. The Son of God. I believe he died and rose again. I believe he paid for us all.
I believe he's here now.
I believe that he's here, standing in our midst,
here with the power to heal.
With the power. To forgive. I believe in you, Lord. I believe you are the Son of God. I believe you died and rose again. I believe you paid for us all.
And I believe.
It's time for our children's message. And you know what? Who doesn't like balloons? Balloons are one of those amazing things that when you get a balloon that's filled with helium, it's amazing that it just gets to float right up. You can always just let that go, and it just seems to fly away. It can be really sad if you've ever had your balloon get away from you. This balloon has a nice little weight at the end of it, so it's not going anywhere. Have you ever wondered what it would take, though, for you to float away with balloons? I kind of did some of the math to figure out what it would take for you to have enough balloons to fly away. You would need about 5,500 balloons, give or take a few. And that's just to lift you up off of the ground. Oh, that's a lot of balloons. But we heard in our reading today that Jesus, while with all of his friends, just started rising off of the ground and went up into the clouds and returned to heaven. It was wonderful. All of his friends and disciples were just in awe as he just completely went straight up back to his heavenly Father. They were in awe of this, just as it would be really amazing if all of a sudden one of your friends just started rising from the ground and he promised that he would return one day. Now, this isn't to say that Jesus did something really amazing and that was just the end of the story. Jesus did this so you know where you're going one day. Just like if we let this balloon go, it would pop and eventually come back down. Jesus did the opposite. He came down to go back up. So now you get to go up, and we know that we have a place with our Heavenly Father. We know that he has gone somewhere and promises that you will be with him. Just as Jesus has gone up and used the word we call ascended, you now know that you will be Jesus, be with Jesus, and that he is with you. That is amazing news because I don't have enough money for 5,500 balloons. So, with that, let's turn to God in a word of prayer. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for going to heaven and making a place for us. Thank you for being with us now. Thank you for all that you do. In your name, amen. As we celebrate and celebrate what Jesus has done, we have a song that's been prepared by our kids in our school, and let's turn to them right now as they sing for joy. As we celebrate that joy that we have, as we rejoice in what our God has done for us, let us confess that faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Sinners from the claims of hell, and with hush.
shout, our souls are free. Death defeated by Emmanuel. Now he's standing in the place of honor, crowned with glory on the highest throne, interceding for his own beloved, till his Father calls to bring them home. Then the skies will part as the trumpet sounds, hope of heaven or the fear of hell. But the bride will run to her lover's arms, giving glory to
God's grace, his mercy, and his peace to you this day as we gather rejoicing in what our Lord has done. As we look at our text today, we will be in Luke 24, reading about the ascension of our Lord, if you would like to follow along and bring out your Bibles. But as we do so, it's one of the things that has been noted by many people, whether it's in literature, whether it's in films, whether it's in stories, that Americans, we like our neat, tidy, happy endings. We like to have things that have been rolled up, tied into a nice, neat package, and end wonderfully. Ascension could almost seem like that nice, neat, perfect ending to Jesus' life and ministry. The disciples are gathered. He's gone to Galilee. He is with them, and they now stand there. And as he is there, he ascends back to heaven. It seems almost perfect. And this is the end of the life and ministry of our Lord and Savior. Some have made a comparison as I've been going through and listening to a lecture that brings up King Arthur. For those of you that look and know anything about King Arthur, Arthurian mythology, you know that there's no two Arthurian legends that are the same. So if this isn't your Arthur, bear with it. That Arthur comes back to Brittany and finds that his nephew has completely destroyed the country. And he has to go with his knights that have been going and questing for the Grail to try and win back his nation, his homeland that he fought for. And they are completely destroyed. But there is hope given as he is wounded, as he gets to go to a land far away, to go and heal and recover. And Britain is given the hope that one day King Arthur will return. For those that like World War I or II a bit better, this Arthurian hope of the king who will return was something that came up in World War I and II, of the once and future king that will save England. And this almost becomes the way we talk about ascension. Ascension almost kind of becomes this weird way of, and now Jesus went, and one day he will return from the clouds. Don't worry, this is why he's no longer with us. This is why Jesus has just disappeared for a time. But he will come back and make things right and perfect, and we will walk with him. Problems that were had is post-World War II, once we got into kind of the modern era, slip of the tongue, they're not saying error. Like the chuckles, it's good to have people back. We now have the issue of when we started going to space. Cosmonauts from the Soviet Union went up into space, came back saying, no sign of God up here. And some of the ways we talk can make it sound like that. Where is Jesus? He's in the clouds. And we start to see that this way of talking can lead to that problem of, why isn't Jesus with us? Why isn't Jesus here today? And so this is where I want to try and help us as we talk, as we celebrate, as we rejoice, as we look at Luke 24 to hear and to see that this isn't the picture-perfect ending that we might be looking for or longing for in Jesus' ministry. No, this is not where we look and celebrate and rejoice that things are done. This is where we see that what Jesus has done is now taking on a new form, and he is doing great and wondrous blessings in your life. He is now doing wondrous things, and the mission of God has not ended at all. The mission of God and his blessings for you just now aren't physically walking around in Israel. And so if you have your Bible with you, as we look, starting at verse 44, we hear Jesus say to them, "These are my words that I have spoken to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." And he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. We see one of the very first blessings, one of the very first blessings that we celebrate with ascension, that we celebrate with our Lord ascending to heaven, is that he ascends the disciples' understanding. He lifts up our understanding of what he came to do. He lifts up that understanding where we were bogged down with everything that we think Jesus came to do, as 2,000 years ago or today. And I guarantee you it will continue on until he calls us home. People are filled with misunderstandings of Jesus, misunderstandings of his mission and purpose, misunderstandings of why he came, what he came for, and we start to make it about what we want, what we are longing for. We start looking for our own picture-perfect endings that we can then take Jesus' works and turn it into. Jesus instead opens our minds to hear, both in the Old Testament and the New, both throughout all of God's words, that his word has been firm and unchanging, that he has done marvelous things that he has planned out from before the foundations of the world for you, that he has something amazing, and that is the mission of what Jesus actually came for. It was not what the disciples thought of the ousting out of the Romans. It was not what they were thinking, that God was going to come down and establish a new kingdom just like David's kingdom. Instead, we see that his kingdom was literally not of this earth. His kingdom was literally not smack dab in the middle of Jerusalem. God ascended just as he came down from heaven. Jesus returned, showing that his reign is not one that was physical, but was one that surpasses kingdoms that come and go. And he opened their minds to see that plan of salvation for the entire world, regardless of place. He opened their minds to understand that what God was doing was greater than what we had, and to see that plan that required God himself to come down, from on high, to take on flesh and blood, to come down and be born an infant. And we see that this becomes that understanding where we see more than just a comprehension, but an understanding of belief, an understanding of faith that holds on to what Jesus has done for us, an understanding where we can look and see that Jesus is the heart of all of God's word. This is one of the wonders of ascension, that we have a Lord who opens your mind to see Jesus even in the most unlikely places in God's word, to see that Jesus truly is everywhere in God's word. We even see this in the book of Acts later on, as you will have the Ethiopian eunuch who is going through and reading Isaiah, reading through and hearing of the suffering servant. And many of your minds already make the connection of suffering servant Jesus. This is one of the things we celebrate and rejoice in, that God has done that for you. He has let you have eyes that can see that plan and hearts that know that Jesus is doing amazing and wonderful things. But what that understanding is where we see that next thing in our reading today. What that understanding is for and what that good news is where we see in verse 46. And he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead." This is where we see what is so bizarre, what is so unheard of, what the disciples struggle with and what we can still struggle with today. That The reason that our Lord and Savior came down from heaven was to suffer, was to die, was for Easter's joy, was to pay the price that you could now know forgiveness, liberty, and life in him, was so that you could now have that healing and restoration, that there was no one else who could pay that price. This was now what he has done. And his ascension signs off and seals that, so there is no shadow of doubt that death truly does have no power over Jesus, because there is no death that can capture him. There is no death to be had. He is not here to die. There is no reason for him to die again. He has paid the price once and for all. And now we hear throughout God's word, throughout the epistles, that he is at his Father's side. He is there as the ascended Lord, still with those marks that he raises up and says, this is the glorious news. This is what I have done for you, that you now have eyes and ears that can believe and cling on to what his marks have done for you. We rejoice that those marks and wounds are in heaven. We rejoice that what he has done is ascended, because whether we catch it or not, Jesus took on flesh. God took on flesh and came down. He returned with his body. He returned in that flesh that he took on when he came down. God, who took on humanity, ascended in his humanity. He ascended in his wounds, in that body that was resurrected. And so now you have a Lord who perpetually, who always shows that he died and rose again for you. This is where we see that joy, that glory, that wonderful news of what God has done. And this is where we see how that mission is not yet done. For we now see and rejoice as he then sends us on, saying, it is not done just because I'm going to my throne that I came from. But as we turn to our last portion of the reading today, we hear Jesus continue. That repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in my name for all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And behold, I am sending you the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. The mission is not yet done. Jesus has paid it all. Jesus has done it all for you. Jesus has accomplished great and wondrous things and now is seated in power and authority. Now he says, go. Go and tell of this wonderful news. Go John the Baptist style, preaching repentance. But note the difference from John the Baptist. Note that this is not John the Baptist, but John the Baptist with a resolution that we desire. For it's not just note the need to repent of sins, but that there now is forgiveness from those sins. There now is deliverance from those sins, and that we have one in heaven who has done that. Go preach the complete story. Go complete what people now feel, that brokenness that they share, that brokenness that we know is there because of what sin has done to God's creation. Go and finish the mission that God has given to you with power from on high. Go and let others know that there is one in heaven who fights for them, who fights and proclaims wondrous deeds, who now is there for all eternity. Has given you that story of deliverance for them. Jesus hasn't completed the story. Jesus has given you his power and mission so that others could be delivered, so that others could know. This is the wondrous news of ascension. This is the wondrous news of this forgotten holiday and festival. This is the wondrous news of what we celebrate lifting up songs of praises for, that we have a Lord who so loves you that he has clothed you with power from on high, has given you his mission and task, and he has given you a story that now is part of your life, because he is risen and he is alive. He is ascended and is sitting on power and sitting in that right hand of his Father. And this is where we now get to rejoice as God's people, seeing that story continue on in our life, not ending maybe in a picture-perfect happy ending, but with a greater joy, a joy that lasts forever, because it has that happy ending. We now know that God has won, and he is victorious. In Jesus' name, amen. As we rejoice and as we give thanks to God this day, we continue to see that wondrous news. We continue to proclaim in all that we say and do what he has done. Our kids have prepared in their classroom a song where they are going to be lifting up their praises to God. Let's turn to them at this time. Let us always be glad in what God has done. Let us rejoice and be thankful. As we lift up our tithes, our thank offerings, as we join together giving thanks to God, there are many ways you can help support this ministry here at Beautiful Savior. With those gatherings of our gifts, our tithes, our offerings, as we lift up gifts that are just a portion of what God has given to us. As we turn to God, there are many ways you can help us here, whether that be through the Give Plus app, through the mail, through the links on our website. We give thanks for all of those who have continued to help us through this pandemic and who continue to find other ways, even beyond just financial giving. We ask that you continue to keep us in your prayers as we keep on going with that message of a Lord who shows his love for us. Let us turn to him in prayer. Father, we give you but your own. We ask that you would bless these gifts that are gathered. We ask that you would be with us as we continue to use them faithfully. Give us wisdom and guidance in how we use them. We ask your blessing, Lord, as we continue to proclaim what your Son has done. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. As we join together, lifting up our prayers to God, A reminder that if you have prayer requests, to please let us know as we continue to join together as a community, as people of faith, as those that know that we have a God who does hear us. Let us lift up our prayers to God. We turn to you as a whole church, O God, in Christ Jesus, according to your people's needs, the needs of your creation, the needs of those around us. We lift up our prayers to you, Jesus, who has gone up with a shout of joy, with the sound of trumpets, and you have ascended triumphantly, and you are now seated at your Father's right hand. Give us lips that proclaim that good news, Lord. Have that joy in our hearts and minds so that we would continue to hold fast as well as bring others to that wonderful news that there is forgiveness of sins. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, help us to hear that command to go into the world and proclaim to all of creation that redemption, that remission of sins. We pray, Lord, that you would be with those that are out in the mission field, that you would be with your church to give her your spirit and power from on high. We pray, Lord, for those that are baptized, for those that are newly baptized, those that are going through confirmation. We pray, Lord, for those that are continuing to seek out a church and for churches as they go through this difficult time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, you promised that this is not the end, but that you would return and that all enemies are now under you, that you have authority over all of the earth. Help us to remember that you are the one who is in control, even when we feel like things are out of our control, when we feel like things are beyond our control, that nothing is outside of your control, Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we lift up those that are celebrating and rejoicing this day, celebrating and rejoicing that gift of life. We pray, Lord, with one of our school families, with one of our students, Murado, at the birth of triplets. We give thanks, Lord, as a congregation for the birth of Cord and of Zion. We ask your blessings upon them and their families. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray, Lord, that you would be with those that are sick, those that need strengthening, those that are going through times of healing and recovery, those that are going through difficult times, separated from family and friends, those that are mourning and grieving the loss of a loved one, those that are in nursing cares and recovery units. Hear us as we lift up those on our hearts and minds and those on our prayer list, including Flora, Brian's family, Renee, and Lisa, as well as those on our hearts and minds. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And in all of these things, Lord, help us to have eyes that are fixed on you and what you have done for us with shouts of joy and with triumph. Hear us as we join together, praying as you have taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As we go this day, rejoice in what God has done for you and receive his blessings. The Lord bless your comings in and your goings out, from this time forth and forevermore, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lift up joy always as you go forth in God's name. Let us join together in our closing song.
the Lord alone, our life and health and peace. His mercies and his loving kindness never cease. In the Lord alone, our life and health and peace. In the Lord alone. In the Lord alone.
As we close off our service today, a couple of announcements that we have, and that is that